Good morning, dear students, and I'll be beginning with this harbour and dock engineering online mode. Due to this coronavirus scale thing, unfortunately we are unable to meet, but I hope that my online classes will be sufficient enough for you to understand. In case if you are facing any difficulties, you can always either you can put in the chat box in the Google Classroom, or you can personally email me, or and like I am always approachable. So this harbour and dock engineering, as I have already told earlier also, it is four parts. This E2 is divided into four parts, and this is one, this is the fourth one, which is the last but not the least. Okay, so this is we have studied all the modes of transportation till now, and this last, that is water transport. For this purpose, we'll be studying this harbour and dock engineering. So, this harbour and dock engineering is divided, basically I'll be dividing into five classes. Okay, first is the natural phenomenon, means like what are the various forces of water and the seas which we have to encounter with the different ships while they are transporting, they have to encounter, and what all facilities which we need to build, they should sustain these forces. So that we have to study first before we proceed on that what exactly we are going to develop based upon available like these forces, natural forces which are occurring. Okay, then we'll go on to the definitions of harbors and ports. Okay, these are many confusing things which are coming up. Okay, some protection works, especially one is called as breakwater. Okay, which is protecting the harbors and ports which is constructed from the seas. Okay, after that we'll come to the docks, that is the basically it is protecting work of the like for the maintenance of the ships and for repairing facilities and to loading and unloading of cargo and goods. And finally we'll come to the operation perspective, that is similar to how traffic engineering, we have to control the traffic moving on the road. So same way we have to also control the traffic of the ships also. Basically we have to guide them properly while they are moving in between the seas and all. So there are various So why water transport? Why is it still used largely or worldwide? I mean, it is used historically. So people definitely they can walk, but not everybody can swim. But like after boats were built, so later on water transport became very cheap. So it is very cheap mostly because we don't have to create any special way for movement of the different vehicles of water transport. Like for example, we are having railway, we have to build the rails. For roadways, we have to build, construct roads. Okay, airways also definitely similar to waterways, but airways require a very costly fuel. But in case of water transport, this is a very cheap motive transfer, power is also very cheap. So we cannot expect that very high power and very sophisticated fuel is required for its working. And it also has a high load carrying capacity. Most of the bulk of trade, international trade, is still carried by water transport because it is very cheap. So there is overall development of commerce and trade possible. So various new waterway routes are, of course, they are very much useful because of this cost. Okay, and one more thing is that people, the countries which are having ocean, that is sea borders, for them the navy is also there, so it can also provide some good means of defense. Okay, disadvantage, definitely it has a very slow operation. Okay, usually the speed of ships is measured in knots, and one knot is approximately 1 km/h. So it is a very slow operation, like the ships usually don't exceed more than 25 or 30 kmph. Okay, so it requires more time like it may require about 15 days to go from India to China, for example. Okay, whereas by airway it will just take maybe 4 or 5 hours. Then another thing is that water should be available at sufficient depth. You have studied this fluid mechanics, so you know that how much part of the any water body is submerged. So that submerged portion should not hit any object which is below, say on the ocean floor or anything like that. If there is a collision with ocean water, then there is be there will be leakage due to the accident which is caused, and the ship will then sink. Okay, so that's why this water should be available at sufficient depth. If this is not present, then we have to create a special waterway, and this will require a special cost. So that we'll study a little bit later. Then it is very risky in case of ocean storms. So the sea, it is very, very unpredictable, and it has huge ocean storms. Sometimes the waves are as high as 80 feet, 90 feet in Pacific Ocean. That is the height of a like 10-story building of one wave. And you can imagine that suppose a ship is standing and you are seeing a wave of 10-story high, then you can imagine that what problem the sailor will be facing. So then there is a limited water transport in hinterlands. Hinterlands means areas which are like say mountainous or very remote located areas. Okay, why limited? Say for example in Himachal Pradesh or in Uttarakhand. So we will not find any water transport there because it is very difficult. It is very rapid transport. It is very dangerous to transport anything by water. Okay, say landlocked countries. Okay, only limited river or lake transport is possible. So this limited river and lake transport is also they have developed. So there are lot of landlocked countries which surprisingly has navy also. Okay, for example, Kazakhstan, which is the largest landlocked country, it has navy. Okay, Switzerland has a merchant navy. So Switzerland, basically, why they have navy? So I have just attached this YouTube video. You can go through it. Okay, mostly these ships they can sail from the rivers and they can access the sea from the rivers. So most of the trade, say for example, Switzerland, there is this Rhine River which flows from Switzerland through France, maybe slightly touching Belgium and all, and then it moves and it goes to the like northern channel somewhere near UK. So like it moves towards the north side. So for that also there is Switzerland has its own merchant navy, so that most of its goods with the outside world, trade with the outside world, is made through this Rhine River only. Okay, so still in spite of these disadvantages, still water transport is used mostly for transporting cargo, because a huge bulk of cargo can be transported slowly. Okay, cargo, it doesn't require much, I mean urgency is not there. Okay, but for example, if a person is traveling for 1 month in the ship, then definitely they will be very much like irritated in the modern days. Okay, so we have like within just 7 days we are so much irritated with this lockdown. So you can imagine a life with 15 days earlier people were sailing from India to UK to US. It used to take like as high as 14 days, 15 days to transport. Okay, but still it was the only mode of transport before air started. So this all is happening. So these natural phenomena, so there are 5 natural phenomena which we'll be studying. Okay, first is called as littoral drift. Then the waves which are present, these are basically different types of forces. Okay, so we'll just go on the tides, like what is the different tides, you are already knowing some of it. Okay, then what causes water hammer and how it affects the seashores, and then we go on to some of the shore protection works also which is present. Okay, so first is called as littoral drift, the first one. So basically littoral drift is that, see, the sea is always in action, okay, due to various reasons. So maybe due to gravity or due to wind and all, these waves are created. Also these waves, often they are created and they move from one sea to another, and they are keeping, like they are always moving on the move. Okay, so these waves, they keep on approaching the seashore. Okay, you can see in this figure also. So when the direction of this wave approach is not exactly in line with the direction of the sea coast, okay, as you see that this sea coast is in horizontal and this purple arrow is slightly inclined.
So in that case, these waves, when they approach, they retract, they retreat back, they hit the shore, they come back. When they come back, they carry along with them some sand particles, okay? So they are regularly washed down and deposited at coastlines of foreshore by the action of impinging waves. Impinging means like dashing waves which are created. So this process consists of repetitive action of erosion. Then these waves get carried away by erosion, then they are carried by suspension. These waves are retreated back, and then again when another waves come, they are deposited in some other direction. So there is a forward drift, as you are seeing. So since this is a slight angle, so this is a forward drift. So this drift is called as littoral drift, and this factor is important to choose a proper harbor or port location. So because if we are choosing a location where there is a regular drift, so it will keep on eroding all the cement concrete shore which we have created especially for the loading and unloading of the ships, okay? So we have to take into care that this flow, this longshore current, is not in this direction, which is like it will erode the newly constructed shores.
The next force of the seas, which is very important, is tides. So you know what gravity does to us, okay? Unfortunately, we cannot move, we cannot fly like birds. So we are like, gravity holds us back to the ground, okay? In the same way, the gravity, not just of the earth, but also of the celestial objects, are also affecting us largely. And we can see their effect on the tides. So due to the gravity of sun and moon, these tides are caused, okay, due to which there is a difference in the water level. The sun and moon, they attract the water which is present in the ocean towards themselves, and this causes these tides. So what are the different tides and how they are affecting, that we'll just glance. So tide is basically rise and fall of sea surface due to gravity of sun and moon. Okay, so both sun and moon, both of them affect the ocean. So high tide is also called as flood tide or rise, and low tide is also called as fall or ebb, EBB, ebb. So both these, they are occurring in the similar duration, twice in 24 hours and 50 minutes. Okay, and the height of the tides depends upon various factors. It is not uniform throughout. So sometimes there is coastal irregularity, so the tide heights is less. If the coast is more irregular, it also depends upon the depth of water. For example, the height of tide in Pacific Ocean is very high because the depth of Pacific Ocean is very high. So the volume of water is also very more. And it also depends upon wind and other factors. So basically two tides that is very important for us. One is the spring tide, which occurs once every 15 days on full moon as well as new moon, both full as well as new, okay? And the rise and ebb, both are maximum in this case. So the difference between this rise and ebb, if we calculate, so it will be always, it will be a maximum in case of this spring tide. Therefore, whenever we are calculating any height difference, the tide difference, this we measure the tide height of the ocean during full moon as well as during the new moon, because during these seasons this height will be the maximum. So during other days it is not very important, okay? So then there is neap tide, when the moon is in her quarters, means say half moon. So the moon, if it is like appearing in the like semicircular fashion, so we say that moon is in quarters. So this rise and ebb are minimum. So the difference between this rise and ebb, that we'll be calculating. So the spring tide difference is usually 1.5 to 2 times the neap tide difference. So usually the cargo facilities are the highest during neap tide because there is not much difference. Whereas during the spring tide, usually they are low because the height difference, if it is very high, say about say 5 to 6 or even 10 meters in between the low and high tide, then it is very difficult to berth the ships. We'll study this term, what is berthing, what is mooring and all. But basically to bring the ship to one side, to dock it properly and to load and unload the goods. usually in case of the low tide, it is difficult to unload the goods because the goods from the ship, when they are loaded to the dock, they have to climb a gradient. And the other way around, in case of high tide, when there is a loading takes place on the ship, then they have to, from the ground is at a lower level and ship is at a higher level, so they have to climb a gradient. So that's why usually this loading and unloading activities is not done during high tide and low tide respectively. Okay, loading is not conducted during high tide and unloading is not conducted during low tide. Next, that is most important phenomenon is the waves. Okay, these waves, sea waves, I hope everybody have visited the seashore and they have experienced the sea waves, which are occurring almost in all the seas around. So these sea waves are basically formed due to two things. One is the wind and one is the water action. So the water action, I mean, we'll not study here, but mostly due to the wind, they are carried forward. So it is the most incomprehensible natural phenomenon. Means lot of models have been developed to, researches is going on to model these waves. That now suppose this phenomenon is this way, suppose it is a new moon and suppose this is the river boundary, river ocean and everything. And with these conditions, already we know what will be the height of the wave which will be impacting. So that nobody is able to predict till now. So this formation of storm waves and open seas, the formation of storm waves lead to happen in the open seas. So these storm waves which are happening, they are just stationary. Okay, two types of waves are there. One is oscillation, one is translation. So oscillation waves are just stationary. They are just oscillating in their own position. But then due to the wind action, then they start translating also. So main concern is our translating wave. What happens is each and every wave is made of crest and trough. You know very well, crest is the highest portion, trough is the lowest portion. Due to the wind action, this crest gets translated. Okay, and it gets translated so much that sometimes it overhangs. So you can see this overhang is formed. And then it falls with a force. And when it falls with a force, this is a very disruptive force, that on all of a sudden the land is being hit by water. For example, if you are sleeping on your bed and all of a sudden if somebody just throws one bucket of water on you, so what will happen? So same way, it is a very disruptive fall. Okay, so your sleep is also getting disrupted. Same way, even it is a disruptive fall which is happening with a lot of impact. So now one good thing is that any unevenness of this seabed or surface is able to break the waves on travel. Okay, for example, if you are not waking up and your mother is throwing some water on you, so if there is some unevenness on the floor, then your mother is not able to reach properly, and maybe she has to throw from long distance, so that's why that impact is not created. So this unevenness of bed surface, is this advantage is there, that the waves cannot hit the land with that much impact which is expected. So this unevenness is usually, it is just created deliberately, or sometimes it is available naturally. So wherever it is available naturally, that advantage is taken, and harbor dock place, that is one of the good location to build a harbor. Otherwise, we have to do it artificially. So next, that is very important, is that the physics of waves, what are the different forces which the waves are happening. So just height of waves, as well, I was saying that sometimes the height is up to 50 to 60 feet is very common in Pacific Ocean. Okay, so it is very difficult for the ships to traverse in Pacific Ocean. Okay, they sometimes, a lot of ship routes avoid a large portions of the Pacific Ocean. Same thing in Atlantic also, it is slightly less, but the Bermuda Triangle might be you have heard of. So with this 40 feet high waves, you can imagine that how the ships will be moving about. Okay, but whereas in Mediterranean and North Sea, they are the most calm and cool seas around, and we'll see the least height of waves, and it is a very easy to ride ships in this case. Okay, so next, what are the different forces which cause the waves. So these waves cause basically four forces. You can remember that these four forces are in four directions: north direction, east, west, and south direction. Means basically not east and west, but like opposite of the land and in the same direction as the land. Okay, so first force is the compression force, means whenever the waves are hitting the shore, so they are causing a very high compression force, due to which there is a horizontal compression force, due to which there is an impact. So that we have to that protection we have to give for the impact of these waves, otherwise it will break off. Okay, then when these waves are basically hitting this shore, so what happens is they hit this shore and there is an they move upward. So when they move upward, they tend to basically topple anything which is like overhang portion here, that is cantilever portion of some platform, say loading platform or something, or a boarding platform. So they tend to topple this. So this is one shear force which is created. I hope you know this shear force and bending moment and all that. So this shear is created. We have to design for this shear also. Then when the waves are returning back after hitting, when you have seen that waves don't just every time come, there is also a returning thing. So there is a suction which is created. If you have visited any beach or something, you have seen that there is a suction which is created under your feet. If you are standing on just on the sea, banks of the sea, and if the waves are coming on your feet, then you see that when they go back, there is a suction created, and you all like, as when you were kids, you were liking that suction forces. So the same suction force, unfortunately, it causes damage because it takes away maybe some like small concrete particles or some cement particles along with it, and it causes the damage of this shore protection wall. And one thing is that when these waves are like after this hit, they move upward, there is a shear force caused, and then they hit downward with a bang. And when they collapse here, there is it causes erosion near the base, which I have indicated here. So this base can be made up of different things, such as riprap is basically khichdi, you can say. So it is basically khichdi of anything, say broken stones of boulders or construction material, debris of the construction material which is broken down, or say broken bricks, they are also riprap. So all these things, they are just come, they just bring by dumpers, and they dump it in and they provide the base, because it is difficult to make any underwater construction. So that's why the bases are just created based on the riprap. So we have to ensure that these bases are also stabilized. So these four forces, they are very important as any ocean engineer. So then what are the different shore protection works that are conducted? One is the sea wall. So basically sea wall is a like concave wall which is facing the sea. Okay, it is like if the sea is in like say for example, if this is your, say for example, this is the land, then the sea wall is constructed in this way, concave shape, so that any ocean force that is coming here, it is able to hit and it is able to bounce back smoothly, so that it will not create any issues and it will not create any erosion. So these sea walls are made up of concrete. Okay, these sea walls of the concave shape, usually it is 90 degrees curvature is followed based upon what the waves and all impact. So it ensures that the water will recede without creating any erosion. So these sea walls are very common, but unfortunately they are slightly costly. After that, we have something called as bulkheads. So this bulkheads is basically some it is like vertical face of concrete or steel. Like for example, this previous slide which I have shown. So this is a bulkhead. So it's just like vertical thing made up of concrete. So usually if the waves is not of that much impact or something, if it is a very calm sea and if it is a like river or something and not very important port is there, then we can directly, we can make this bulkhead. So, but definitely as I have told earlier, this cowering at base is an issue in the bulkhead case. Then next we have groins. Okay, these groins are basically perpendicular to the coast. Okay, so similar to jetty that I'll describe it later. So these groins basically it breaks the wave impact which is created. So these are, for example, if this is the, so just to explain these groins, for example, this is your sea coast and these waves are just coming in this direction. Okay, so when it comes in this direction, it will, they will hit with impact. So instead of that, what is done is usually this groins are this kind of structures which is created. So that this is just made up of say timber or maybe reinforced concrete or something, so that when the waves are now hitting, they'll not hit with that much impact, and rather they'll, like say this huge waves which are coming, they dash here and they break into individual waves, smaller waves, so that that force is dissipated. So this is about your groins. Then next to tetrapods, I'll describe it later, and breakwater also I'll describe it later. So basically tetrapods are nothing but the like four legged, something like an animal, it is shaped, it is not an animal but it is shaped like four legs are there, similar to maybe molecule structure or something you might have studied, that it is a like 120 degree structure is there. So they are made up of huge concrete blocks are there. They are made up of usually, mostly they are made up of concrete and cast. It is cast and they are thrown, dumped into the sea. So they are arranged themselves properly. So the waves basically they travel around these tetrapods and they don't travel exactly on, they don't hit these tetrapods, but they travel around. When they travel around, then they dissipate the energy. Okay, then breakwater, basically as the name suggests, it breaks the water into two parts. One water is in, outside the sea, outside, basically it is kind of boundary. So one, very rapid waters are present outside this boundary, they kind of like Lakshman Rekha. The breakwater is basically, nothing but Lakshman Rekha. So for that, suppose this is a coast and suppose it is hit by very strong waves. So breakwaters are just constructed maybe slightly in this way, so that all these strong waves, they are stopped here, and this breakwater also suffers all the impact of these waves, so that whatever waters which are present here, they are calm waters, and here ships can come, they can berth anytime. Okay, so that this, whenever these waves are impacting, they will not impact these red color ships which I have drawn. So these breakwaters are also almost, they are present in almost all the ports which are not very much natural. Okay, so we'll study this breakwater slightly in detail later on, that what, how they are constructed and various types of these breakwaters. Okay, so after this we move on to some basic definitions, that what is a harbor and what is a port and what is a dock. So it is very very confusing terms are there. So what is a harbor? Basically it is a basin or haven. Basin is not like your wash basin. Okay, so basin is like any kind of like enclosed structure is called as basin. Same as haven, also same thing. So basin or haven or roadstead of navigable water, not just any water, maybe not in say Bidisha Lake or something like that. So it is any navigable water which is well protected naturally or artificially. It can be well protected either naturally or artificially from the action of winds or waves. Okay, both winds as well as waves situated across the, so where it is situated, across the seashore or river or lake or estuary, anywhere it can be situated, any basically any water transport, and it is connected to a water transport route. So that this is also important. Just like a building a safe structure is not essential, there should be some connection also. So this each and every terminology is important. Okay, so 4-5 things are there. One is the water should be navigable, it is a basin, it is a roadstead. Okay, it is should be protected, well protected also from wind as well as waves, and it should be connected to water transport route also. Okay, so all these definition, all these terms, don't miss the terms when you're writing your definition of a harbor. So some terminology is basin, as I have told earlier. So this basin is not your wash basin, but it is a water reservoir of some required area. Whatever area is required, depending upon how many ships are estimated to come, based upon that we judge that how much basin area will be sufficient for us to make a harbor. So basically harbor is just like kind of protection from the sea, where ships can rest for temporary purpose. Okay, so next is basin. It is navigable only when depth is greater than the draft required for largest ship which is likely to visit the harbor. So then only we can say that it is a navigable thing, because this largest ship we anticipate some largest ship. Okay, not as large as Titanic, but maybe some ships which are usually goods and cargo ships, which are very commonly found in the seas. So this draft, what is this draft? Is basically linear immersion of the ship below the water surface for the ship to remain float in stable conditions. So, and not just the immersion. For example, this is your, say, water body. You say, suppose this is your ship. Say, this is your, say, for example, this is your sea. This is the floor. And this is your ship. So this is not just important. Suppose this is the largest ship which is anticipated, there should be some clearance also after the the deepest point of this immersion. So this clearance is also of importance. So both this together is required, and this is called as draft. Then we can classify the harbors based upon various things such as protection, utility and location. We'll study each and every details in the next class. Based upon protection, we can classify the harbor as natural harbor, semi-natural and artificial harbor. Based upon utility, that what all, how we are using this harbor. Okay, just for refugee purpose means like only temporary stoppage of from the strong wind, then it is that way. Then commercial, say commercial harbor is better, it is called as port only. Then whether it is used mostly for fishing purpose to eat the fish which we get. Okay, or military purpose, or for marina is like tourism purpose, we'll study later on. Or wherever it is located, whether it is located on canal or lake or river or sea or ocean. Based upon these three things, we can classify our harbors.